Hello students, welcome to my lecture series on reinforced concrete structures. In this class I am going to discuss about introduction to design of columns. Before discussing this topic, let me discuss what are the components of building we have. So we have so many components of building, like from top it is a slab, then we have a column, again a slab, then a column and beam, and it is a slab and beam combination, and is a column, and is a foundation. It is for a multi-story building. If you take a common building, a single building, right? For this we have, say this is a slab, and this is beneath of the slab we have the beams, and these beams are supported with a columns, right? And these columns are constructed over a what? Foundation. So these are the major parts of a building. Clear? So if you see, what is the basic difference between a construction and a design? What do you mean by design and what do you mean by construction? You know already, but what is the basic difference between these two, construction and design? If you observe this figure, how we constructed, we have constructed first foundation, then laid a column, then beam and slab. How we design this member? So first we have to design this slab and beam members, then column, then foundation. So from this it clearly shows us the construction will start from bottom to top, whereas design can be done from top to bottom. That means design will first design for slab and beams, then columns, then footings. Whereas construction, first we will construct a foundation, then we construct column, then beams and slabs. So these are the basic difference between the construction and design. So let us talk about today's class. Before proceeding to actual class, as it is introduction to design of column, let us discuss what is a compression member is. What is a compression member? A member which is subjected to compressive force. Say it is a member, any RC member, if it is subjected to a force in this direction and is subjected to a force in this direction, then I can say these are compression members. So if you observe any construction, what are the members are under construction, under compression? So if you see here, this vertical member, this is on this vertical member, a load which is coming on because of this externally applied load and the slab and beam system, and from the ground also we have a reaction. That means this is a vertical member which is subjected to compressive force. I can call this is a compression member, right? So what are the different compression member we have? The compression members are columns, pedestals, booms, right, stanchion. So generally columns and pedestals are used in our general RCC constructions, and boom is used in a crane, and stanchion is, it is a steel member in a truss, right? So in this way we can use the compression members. So what are the compression members which are used in RCC construction? One is column, another is pedestal, right? So let me discuss, or let me define what is the column is. Here the column is a vertical structural member which carries a compressive force, right? So as I told you, a column is a compression member. Compression member means what? It is subjected to a compression force. And one more point you have to discuss here to define the column is whose effective length exceeds 3 times its least lateral dimension. What do you mean by that? As we have decided that our column is a compression member, here you can see this is a column in our actual structure, right? It is subjected to a compressive forces. So that's why I can call it as a compression member. So when you call it as a column, and when you call it as a pedestal, so there is a condition that when you want to, if you want to say it is a column, it should satisfy this condition, whose effective length exceed 3 times its least lateral dimension. So to define that, you should know what is the effective length. That is simply designated with a LEF. What is the effective length and what is the least lateral dimension? See, the effective length means, say when you apply this load, this column will buckle like this, right? And it will bend like this, right? Because of the compressive forces. So the distance between this point and this point, where this point, what is this bent? It is a bent here, the column start bending here from here onwards. At the particular point, the bending is zero. So point A is here, say point B is here. There we have some supports or some forces. So this distance between these two point is called effective length, right? Now at this point your bending moment is zero. At this point your bending moment is zero. And other way you can define this, where effective length of the column means the distance between the two pointer of contraflexure points. So what do you mean by point of contraflexure? You might have studied in your strength of material topic when you are discussing about shear force and bending moment diagrams. So the point of contraflexure means, so if you draw a bending moment for any beam, if you get a bending moment diagram like this, right? And the below the baseline it shows negative, and if above the baseline the bending moment diagram shows positive, and below this negative, right? If you see the bending moment diagram, it is changing its sign from positive to negative to positive and positive to negative. The point at which it changing its sign negative to positive or a positive to negative, this is called, that point is called point of contraflexure. You can call it as a PC. So if you see that particular point, what will be the bending moment? The bending moment will be zero. The similar case here, at this particular point, if bend is zero, so it is called a point of contraflexure point, PC1, I can say, right? And this is a point of contraflexure point, PC2, right? So at these two particular points, the bending moments are zero. If you measure the distance between these two, the distance is called effective length, right? So this effective length exceeds 3 times its least lateral dimension. So what do you mean by least lateral dimension? So this is a vertical member, say one structural vertical member. If you cut the section here and see, it will be like this, right? It will be like this. So of course, assume that it is a rectangular column. So this is a B and this is a D or the dimension. So what the word dimension? Least lateral dimensions. So this is a vertical direction, longitudinal direction. The direction which is perpendicular to the longitudinal direction is a lateral direction. In lateral direction of a column, we have two dimensions, that is width and the depth of the beam in cross section. This is a cross section of a column. I can call it as a cross section of a column. So these two, B and D, are the cross sectional dimension of a column. So least lateral, or I can say it is the lateral dimension of a column. What do you mean by least lateral dimension? The least lateral dimension means the least value among B and D. That is called a least lateral dimension. So from this I can say the definition of a column is, it is a compression member, that means it is subject to two compressive forces from top and bottom, and another condition has to satisfy to call it as a column. The least lateral dimension is exceed 3 times least lateral dimension. So L effective is greater than 3 times its B or D. What are the B or D? B or D are the least lateral dimension. Then only we can call it is a column. Right? So let us go for next flow definition. What is the pedestal is? It is the opposite to this. It is a smaller than a column in size. The pedestal is a vertical compression member whose effective length is less than 3 times its least lateral dimension.
So here LE is effective length, and it should, if it is less than the least lateral dimension, it may be D or it may be a B. Sometime least may be B or sometime least may be. In the, if satisfy this condition, this type of compression members are called a pedestal. Right? So these are the basic difference between column and pedestal at the compression member which are used in RCC construction. So what are those? Column and pedestal. Finally, I will define the column. Column is a vertical member which carries compressive force or compressive loads and whose effective length exceed 3 times least lateral dimension. Right? That is a minimum dimension of the cross-sectional dimensions. That is a column. And pedestal means a pedestal is a vertical compression member whose effective length is less than 3 times its least lateral dimension. I think you got the difference between these two. Only effective length and relation between the effective length and least lateral dimensions. So let us classify the columns. The columns are classified based on the various parameters, like based on the shape of cross section. What is that? Based on the shape of cross section, based on type of loading, and based on the slenderness ratio, and finally pattern of lateral reinforcement. So we'll discuss one by one in detail later. Let us classify what are the classification of columns based on their respective points. Say first take the shape of the cross section. Now on, if you cut the column, what shape you get based on that? So it is a column. If you cut the section somewhere here, right, what shape you get based on that? We get, the columns are classified as, if you get the square shape, then we can call it as a square sectional column. Then we have, if it is a rectangle, rectangular column. If it is a circle, circular column. And sometime we may have a composite column also. The composite column means, a composite means a column which is made up of a two different material. To, in order to increase the strength, we may use sometime a concrete along with a steel columns. That is called, those columns are called composite columns. These columns are based on what? Cross section. Next, we are based on the type of loading which is coming onto the column. They are axially loaded column. Then we are eccentrically loaded column. You know, axially loaded column means, if it is a column, if it is the axis of the column, the vertical axis of column, if load is acting exactly on this axis of the column, then we can call it is a axially loaded column. If it is not acting on the axis, it is acting somewhere some distance from the axis of the column, but then we can call it as a eccentrically loaded column. In this eccentrically loaded column, there are two subcategories: a column subjected to axial load, and there we have a uniaxial bending. Then a column is subjected to a axial load, then we have a biaxial bending. These things we discuss in detail later. So next classification is slenderness ratio. What is that? Slenderness ratio. Based on this slenderness ratio, these are classified as long columns and short columns. And based on the pattern of reinforcement, based on the pattern of reinforcement, lateral reinforcement provided, these columns are classified as column with lateral ties and column with helical tie reinforcement. This can be exclusively can be used for circular column. Here I want to discuss one point here. When we are designing a beam, so there is a transverse reinforcement we have provided in the form of stirrups, right? So these are the stirrups for a beam. Similarly, when we are designing a column, you also used here transverse reinforcement. You know what transverse means? The reinforcement provided perpendicular to the main column reinforcement. Those are called a transverse reinforcement. Here in this direction, we will provide a transverse reinforcement like this. So if you provide in a beam in this direction, these are called a stirrups. The same transverse reinforcement you will provide like this, they are called as a ties, or say lateral ties. Okay, what is the function of these two? Here the stirrups are keeping this main reinforcement in position, right, without disturb their original positions. Similarly, your lateral ties also keeping your main reinforcement in position without disturbing their position well at the position of placing of concrete or at the time of vibrating the concrete. Those times your column reinforcement or beam reinforcement should not be disturbed. That's why we have to provide a shirab in beams and ties in columns. So let's discuss one by one here. So based on the shape of cross section, so these are classified as square. First one is square. You know, square means all sides are same. So this is a square cross sectional column. So the side of the column is A. The area of that particular cross sectional column is A into A. So it is A square. And here we have L and H. That is the unsupported length of the column. What is the capital here? Here, unsupported length of the column. That means we are measuring the column height or length before buckling of this column. That length or height of the column is called it as a what? Length or height of the column. Right? Then we have a rectangular column. If you see, for rectangular column, we have a two dimensions. This is a B. This is a B and this is a D. Clear? So this is the vertical direction. We have the main reinforcement here. Right? And these are the main reinforcement which are provided. And the horizontal direction what you show on, these are what? A ties here. What are those called? Ties. If you cut a section here, somewhere here, you will get a cross section of A, this column, B into D. So we can call it as a rectangular column. You know the gross area of that rectangular column is B into D. Right? So next, you go for a circular column. A circular column means the cross section of circle appears as a what? A circle. Right, this is the circular column and the outer C. This is outermost is your column face. And here we have a gap between what? A reinforcement. This inner ring of the column is, it is a reinforcement. That is, I can call it as a lateral ties. And these small circles are a vertical reinforcement of a column. Right. You project like this, and it will make it a 3D form. We will get, so it's not clearly coming because of this cursor, right? So it is a vertical, I can say vertical circular column. So the small circles are called a main reinforcement bar and bars, and these are inner circle ring is a lateral tie provided in the circular column. And outer is outer face of the concrete column. This is what the space between this ring of the reinforcement or lateral tie of the reinforcement and the outer ring is. It is a cover provided in the column. So you know, as it is a circular in cross section, so area of the circular cross section of column can calculate by pi by 4 into d square. Here capital D is the diameter of this column. Then we have a composite section of a column. As I already told you that composite means combination of a two materials, right? In order to increase the strength of a column without increasing the cross sections of our concrete column, in the concrete column we will provide in between some steel columns, say in the form of say I section or some sections. So those called a composite sectional column. So here concrete is one material. And this I section T is another material, so we can call it as a composite section column. See here, column with RCC and rolled steel section. It is used to carry heavy loads, so that is called a composite section. Right? You can see here in figure, this is a RCC column, and in between the RCC column, we have a steel section. So then it is called a what? Composite section. Right? Then next classification is based on the type of loading. You know, the loading may be axially loaded or eccentrically loaded. But axially loaded means in this figure it is clearly shows that. So this is a column, right? And this is the axis of the column in horizontal direction. This is another directional column. And you apply the load in z direction. So this is the axis of the vertical axis of a column. This is x direction, z direction. The load is exactly acting on this axis of the column. Then I can call it as a axially loaded column. An axially loaded column, the column is purely subjected to compressive stress only. So if I will if you cut the section here for a column, we will get, take a section XX, and if you see the sectional dimension of this column, say this is that, okay, and these are the two axes what we can see on the top of this. Okay, now this is a center of that. If we apply a load here at this particular point, say P, I can say we apply the load on this particular point, then we can call it as a axially loaded column. In this, the stress occur is purely compressive stress. Okay, then next category of a column is called eccentrically loaded column. So in nature, pure axially loaded column does not exist in our RCC construction, but there are some assumption or some values we have taken for make it axially loaded column. So here the definition given by IS 456-2000 for eccentrically loaded column, that is, load is act through the point which is away from the axis either direction, known as eccentrically loaded column. Right? What, when we consider it is eccentrically loaded column, so there is a condition that E refers to the eccentricity here. The minimum eccentricity value should not exceed this value, that is L by 500 plus D by 30. L is the unsupported length of the column, D is the lateral dimension of the column under consideration. Suppose if your E eccentricity value is less than or equal to this value, then we can call it as a what? Axially loaded column. And there is a one more condition, whether this value or 20 mm. So 20 mm also given another condition. At max, if the E value is less than or equal to 20 mm, or which satisfy this condition, that is L by 500 plus D by 30 value, another value is there. So if that those values are less than this, either 20 mm, or if you simplify these, we'll get 0.05 D, then we can call it as a your axially loaded column. If these values exceed this, so E min, if the E minimum is exceeding this L by 500 plus D by 30, or at minimum value of 20 mm, then we can type of column, we can call it as a eccentrically loaded column. Here the eccentrically loaded column will shown here, say that is, say E value is greater than E minimum or 0.05 D. in these conditions we can call it as a what? Eccentrically loaded column. If this E value less than E minimum or less than 0.05 D, then we can call it as what? Axially loaded column. So here we can see the figure. So this is our column like this. In this direction we have an axis, and in this direction we have an axis. Our force P is, load P is acting not at the intersection of these two axes. It is acting some distance here. This distance is E. If this distance is greater than E minimum and 0.05 D, then we can call it as a eccentrically loaded column. As I already told you, a purely axial loaded column is not possible in RCC construction. There, that's why we have given some provision, that is 20 mm, or that E value must be less than or equal to 0.05 D. It has to satisfy any of the criteria, then we can call it as a axially loaded column. If greater than that, we can call it as a eccentrically loaded column. In eccentrically loaded column, again we have two subcategories. When column is subjected to axial load and it is a uniaxial bending. What is that uniaxial bending? I will explain what is this here with respect to considering the plan of this a 3D figure of a column. So here is the cross section of this column, and this is our what? A XX directional axis, right? And say assume that it is a ZZ direction. Okay, and we have another mutually perpendicular direction that is not shown. It is a vertical direction in this direction, and the load is not acting here. Now if it is acting here, we can call it as a axially loaded column, right? But the load is acting somewhere here, sorry, somewhere here. This is a P, right? Okay, now this distance is E. This E value is, according to this definition, greater than E minimum and greater than 0.05 D. That's why I'm calling it as a asymmetrically loaded column. See, it is a uniaxial bending. What do you mean by uni? Uni means unique, a single. And axial bending means, as the load is acting on the axis of the member, that is called it is axially loaded, but it is the bends. So it is a force. The P is acting in this direction, and it is acting at a distance of E from this original point. So it has some E. That's why here we get a moment here. Moment nothing but what? Force into perpendicular direct distance. So force is P here, and the perpendicular distance is E. This will give me the bending, and this column will try to bend in this direction, only one direction. That's why it is called uniaxial bending. So this is the load, and this is the distance we have, that is in the form of eccentricity. Because of that, your column will bend in this direction, in only one direction. That's why it is called a uniaxial bending. Then we have another type of eccentrically loaded column, is column subjected to axial load, but then we have a biaxial bending. So see here, this case, this is a column. If you observe the surface of this column, so we get the eccentricity value in both the direction, along the x direction and along the y direction, right? If you see here, so this is, assume that this is the x direction, right? What is this direction? X direction. And what is the y direction? So if you measure the load is acting somewhere here, right? If you measure the direction with respect to x, it is a EY. If you measure the along the x direction with respect to y axis, it is a EX. That means we have a eccentricity of this load along x axis, along y axis. So in two direction it has a eccentricity value. So in two direction we have a bending for this column. That's why bi means two. That's why you can call it as a biaxial bending. So you can, it will be better understand if I explain by taking only cross section of the column. Say it's a cross section of column. So assume that this is x direction with this particular case, right? Okay, and I'm assuming, so it is a y direction for time being. There I had discussed y. Anyhow, these three axes are mutually perpendicular axes. Now my load is acting somewhere here. It is at a distance of some EX. So this is a distance of some EX. Right? So this is a EX. And some distance of a EY here. So we have a load here, like this, and we have some distance in this direction, right, and somewhere in this direction also, right, in this direction also. So this is a perpendicular distance for this load. Assume that this is a load. So EX is a perpendicular distance in this direction, and EY is a perpendicular distance in this direction. So this is EX, and this is a, and this is EY. This is a EY. So load is here. Perpendicular distance EX, perpendicular distance EY. So we are getting a bending moment in X direction, in this direction, right? It will bend like this, and this direction also. Here in 2D we can see in same direction, but they have two different directional bending moments. So that's why we can call it as a biaxial bending. So we have to design the column, axially loaded columns, or the column with uniaxial bending and column with biaxial bending, and they may be short columns or long columns, right? In this way we can design the columns. So let us see one more classification based on the slenderness ratio. Generally this slenderness ratio is designated with a lambda. Lambda is equal to effective length of the column by least lateral dimension. So here, columns are based on the slenderness ratio, they are categorized as long column and short column. So if you want to shift to be a column is short, then the value of this lambda or effect slenderness ratio must be less than 12. So what is that ratio? Lambda, that is the slenderness ratio. Effective length of the column, that is the LF to the least lateral dimension. Already mentioned you what is the effective length of the column is. So here I will explain again briefly what is the effective length of the column is. Say this is a column, right? And if you apply a load over this, so it tries to buckle like this, right? It tries to buckle like this. Okay, assume that it has supported to some other condition. Those conditions we'll discuss in next class. This is a point 1 and this is a point 2. The distance at this point, the bending moment is 0, and this is point the bending moment is 0. We can call it as a point of inflection or point of contraflexure. The distance between these two points is called a effective length. This length by the, if you draw the cross section of that, you will get a cross section here like this, and this is a B. And this is a D, if it is a rectangular column, the minimum of these two values. So here L effective by a least lateral dimension, maybe a B or what is that? A D value, B or D is less than 12, then this type of column is categorized as short column. Similarly, we can define what is the long column is. It is simply opposite to that. That is lambda equal effective length of the column by least lateral dimension. If the slenderness ratio is greater than 12, then we can call it as a long column. So that is here, if this is a L effective, that is L effective is greater than 12, then we can call it categorized as a what? A long column. So don't confuse here. For a column we have a three definitions right here. A column is when a column, a compression member said to be a column, then the lambda, the effective length of the column to the least lateral dimension is what? Greater than 3. We have at the starting of the class we have defined that. That is a definition of column. What is that? So L effective is greater than 3 times say D. Suppose this L effective by D is greater than 3. We can write like this. Then we can categorize as it is a column. If it is less than that, it is a pedestal. Clear? So any value of LE by D is greater than 3, that is characterized as a column. In that column, again, we have categorized as long column and short column. Suppose that L effective by D is nothing but, in my opinion, it is a least lateral dimension. For example, take if it is greater than 12, it is a, so less than 12, it is a short column. Greater than 12, it is a long column. I think don't confuse here. The values of L by LE by D is 3, LE by D is 12 and less than 12 and greater than 12. LE by D is greater than 3. It is categorized as a column. Finally, in the column, it is a short column or long column means that depends upon again LE by the least lateral dimension. If the least lateral dimension, LE by least lateral dimension less than 12, we characterize as a short columns is greater than 12, long columns. Clear? And then the columns are classified based on their pattern of lateral reinforcement. I already told you, lateral reinforcement means they are called lateral ties. So these are the, for this case I have taken a live example here, a photograph of live construction. So this is a main reinforcement. So these are the main reinforcement which are provided in the vertical direction of the column. And if you see, the reinforcement which is provided along this direction, so in the surrounding of this column like this, if it is a rectangular column, a rectangular shape like this, these are the ties and these are main reinforcement, and these lateral ties are provided perpendicular to this main reinforcement. That's why they are called lateral ties. Okay? And similarly, we can provide a helical reinforcement. Generally, this will be provided for a circular columns. As a transverse reinforcement is in the form of helix or spiral. That is called a helical reinforcement. This is generally provided in your circular columns. So, circular columns, see here, these are the vertical members of a vertical reinforcement. These are the vertical reinforcement, so we can call it as a what? A main reinforcement of a circular column. If you see here in the power spring, so is a spiral, or we can design the shape of helix. We can mold like this of as a helical transverse reinforcement for circular column. Clear? Right. So next we'll discuss codal provision or codal requirement for the design of any type of column. So first criteria concern is minimum eccentricity. So minimum eccentricity required is for deciding whether it is an axially loaded column or eccentrically loaded column. So if you want to design an axially loaded column, there is a condition that so our E minimum or E value must be less than or equal to 20 mm. And another is less than or equal to 0.05 times D. Right? Here, if the values are greater than that, we can call it as a eccentrically loaded column. Based on the type of column, we can go for design of the column. Clear? So, according to the class number 25.4 of IS 456-2000, the minimum eccentricity value is L by 500 plus DRB. As I told you, DRB are the least lateral dimensions by 30, and it is subjected to one more condition, 20 mm. Right. If it is E minimum is greater than this value, then we can categorize it as an eccentrically loaded column. And if less the E minimum less than this particular value, 0.05 D, then we can categorize it as a axially loaded column. Based on we can design the type of column. So let us say here value is less than this, we can design axially loaded column. And then we go for check of L effective by D, whether we have to design axially loaded what short column or long column, and again based on the shape, what shape of column we need to design. So is a rectangular, circular or square. So finally we can come to the conclusion what type of column we have to design, what shape of column we have to design, and on the what type of loading is acting on that column, and based on that what type of column we can design. So those are we have to decide according to these steps. Then we have a lateral reinforcement. As you know, lateral reinforcement is provided in the form of a ties in the columns, right? The area of lateral reinforcement AST, say AST, shall not be less than 0.8% of, sorry, it is not a lateral reinforcement, sorry, I am wrongly read it. So it is a longitudinal reinforcement. Suppose this is a column. So this is the face of the column. We are providing a columns in vertical direction, and say these are the stirrups now. Okay, now these are the longitudinal bars. Longitudinal bars means main reinforcement. According to the code IS 456-2000 for limit set of collapse in compression, flexure, bending is already over when we are designing with beams. Now it is a collapse condition, collapse of compression members. As your column is a compression member, when it is with respect to this limit state, what is that? Limit state of collapse in compression condition. According to that, the minimum reinforcement should not be less than 0.8% of gross cross-sectional area of the column, and not greater than 6% of gross cross-section of the column. It is a theoretical one. 6% is theoretical one, and practically will provide the maximum area of reinforcement limited to 4% of cross-sectional area. So you may confuse here. It is very, very important for your competitive point of view, competitive exam point of view. The minimum reinforcement provided in column is 0.8% and should not be provided greater than 6%, and practically provided as the maximum is 4%. So what is the difference between this 6% and 4%? So we can provide the area of reinforcement up to a 6%, but practically we are providing 4%. What is the reason for that? The reason is here, when you are constructing a multi-story buildings, these columns are extended to different stories. So this is a first story, right? And this is a second story, right? And say I have a two story, one more story on this. And it is a G plus two store, right? In these three floors, we have a columns and column reinforcement like this, right? So theoretically, the 6% is when you provide reinforcement from here to, it is the starting point of reinforcement, it is the ending of this bar, and second bar, it starts from the ending of the first bar to the this here, again third bar of the reinforcement as a main reinforcement start like this. We are connecting end to end, then you can go up to 6% of grass cross-sectional area. But it is not practically viable providing this type of reinforcement. We have to cut the reinforcement, we have to join. Say we are providing the main reinforcement for ground floor to first floor like this. This is the ground floor reinforcement here as a main bar. The first floor reinforcement will be provided from here to here. So this much of reinforcement we are doing as a lapping. For this also we have some coded recommendations, right? This lap length should be provided when you are attaching one bar of reinforcement to the another bar, when we are moving from one floor to the another floor. And similarly, so in the first floor to the second floor. So this is the first floor reinforcement here, main bar, and we are going to the second floor, the reinforcement should be lap the reinforcement of first floor up to some distance, right? So like this, we'll use the lapping length, extra length in the form of lap for a reinforcement. If you provide 6% reinforcement and without it including the lapping, then it will become a over reinforced section. So it will increase the, it will go more than 6%, then it will become over reinforced section. The over reinforced sections are not recommended as per IS 456-2000. That's why in order to overcome this type of problems, initially we are reducing the area of percentage of reinforcement provided in the column, that is 4%. That's why the maximum area of reinforcement provided in the column as a longitudinal reinforcement is 4%. It is a practical, but theoretically it should not be greater than 6%, including what? This 4% and lap length. If you add together, that total should not exceed 6%. Clear? Right. Then we have a minimum number of bars and diameter of bar to be provided. These are the points also, these are the bullet points I can say. These are very, very important for your complete examination. If you are designing a square column, the minimum number of main reinforcement should be 4 numbers. So like this. If the cross section of a column is square, you have to provide here, 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 here. This is the minimum number of bars to be provided. Right. The maximum you can provide more than 4 also. Right. For circular column, the minimum number of bars are 6 here on the periphery of the column. Say this is a circular section, so this is a circular column. So minimum reinforcement, minimum number of main reinforcement will be provided in the circular, so it is a circular fashion, it should come in circular fashion, right? Jumping somewhat, right? Here is a circular column, the minimum number of, the minimum reinforcement provided, minimum main bars are provided are what? 6 in numbers. Clear? Then minimum diameter of bar used, whether it is a circular column or rectangular column or square column, for a main reinforcement is 12 mm, should not less than 12 mm. The maximum permitted spacing along with the periphery of the column is, that is 300 mm. What is that? 300. What do you mean by this? The spacing between periphery of the column, this should not exceed, the maximum should not exceed 300 mm. Right? Okay. And the nominal cover to be provided 40 mm, or the diameter of larger bar, whichever is more. Suppose for a column, if you are using 25 mm bars, and another condition is 40 mm. The maximum of these two will be provided as nominal cover for the column. So my average maximum is 40 mm. So generally we'll provide column, the distance between the reinforcement face and column face is 40 mm. So transverse reinforcement we can provide in the form of lateral ties and helical reinforcement. The diameter of lateral ties or circular rings or helical reinforcement should not be less than the following. That is, 1/4 of diameter of largest longitudinal bar, diameter bar, and 6 mm. Suppose you are providing largest longitudinal bar diameter is 6 mm. The 1/4 of that is, so 16 by 4, right? That is 4 mm. Another condition is 6 mm. So provide 4 mm as a diameter of lateral tie. So the in market 4 mm bars are not available, so we can go with a 6 mm bars only. So next, the pitch of the lateral ties are shall not be more than the following. What do you mean by pitch of the lateral ties? See, that is a vertical spacing, I can say. The vertical spacing, so this is a tie. Say this is a tie. At the distance between two consecutive ties, lateral ties, that is called what? A pitch. What is called a pitch. So least lateral dimension. One is least lateral dimension. Least lateral dimension means what? If it is a rectangular column, so you may have one is B and one is D. Minimum of these two is called a least lateral dimension. It may be least of that. Or 16 times diameter of smallest longitudinal bar. What do you mean by smallest longitudinal diameter bar? Means in a column, you no need to provide all main bars of equal diameter. You may provide the edge columns are larger diameter and the in between columns are smaller diameter. Suppose you are providing the 16 mm dia at the corner one. In between, you may provide 12 mm bars also. That is based on area of steel we are providing. So what is that? 16 times diameter of smallest longitudinal bar. Here smallest longitudinal bar is 12 mm. So at 12 into 16 is a one condition, and another is list of B and D. Another is 300 mm. Among these three, minimum value will be provided as a pitch of this lateral ties, right? Then we have helical reinforcement. Helical means for the circular column, we have a provide the reinforcement in the form of a helical like this. It is like this. And pitch of this is the distance between these two is called a pitch. So that is 1/4 of diameter of largest diameter bar here. So there in the lateral ties, that is the smallest diameter, here largest diameter. If it is a 16 mm largest diameter bar, and 1/4 of that is 16 by 4, 4 mm, right? It is, what is that? The diameter of helical reinforcement provided. The diameter of this helical reinforcement should be 1/4 of 16 mm diameter of largest diameter and 6 mm, whichever the less or which is not less, the provided is not less than these two. If you providing 16 mm, 16 mm by 4, we'll get 4 mm. 4 mm will not be available in market, so we'll go with the 6 mm. Next, what is the spacing of helical reinforcement, a pitch of helical reinforcement? That is, shall not be less than 25 mm or 3 times the diameter of steel bar forming helix. That is 25 mm, 3 times of diameter ball forming helix. And maximum pitch will be 75 mm and 1/6 of core of the diameter of column. This is the maximum condition. It should not be less than that. It is a minimum condition. Those things we have to follow, right? So these are the codal recommendations for today's class. So let me recall what are the things we have discussed for today's class. In today's class, we have defined what is a compression member and what are the different type of compression members. In that, what are the compression members used in our RCC construction? Those are columns and columns and pedestals. And we have defined based on the effective length of the column and the least lateral dimension, what is the short column, so what is the column and pedestal is. Then we have classify our column based on their type of cross sections and lateral reinforcement provided and then type of loading act loader which is acting on that, and based on the standardized ratio we have classified the column. Then we have discussed what is the codal recommendations are there for design of a low columns. So that's all for today's lecture. Thank you.